Just up the street, that empty blue-sided building used to be the old Motown headquarters, Hitsville, USA. Motown left the city for California in 1972, and the next several blocks to the north turned into perhaps the saddest stretch of real estate in the city. Ugly, empty lots and boarded-up buildings with only an occasional going concern.
Orchestra Hall was built in only 4 months and 23 days during the summer of 1919. And as such, it represents the tremendous industry and enterprise of this city. For its first 20 years, it served as the home of the Detroit Symphony Orchestra. And every great name of the concert stage appeared here. Heifetz played here, Caruso sang here, Pavlova danced here. In 1939, because of economic hard times, the orchestra moved from the hall and it reopened 2 years later as the Paradise Theater. The area, known as Paradise Valley, where Joe Louis grew up, was just across Woodward, and it was a vital and active part of the city. Duke Ellington, Count Basie, Lena Horne, every great name in jazz played here at the Paradise Theater, and it flourished for 10 years until 1951. Then it closed and reopened for a time as the Church of Our Prayer with the Reverend James Lofton. Because the hall has a quality that will convey any message with great fervor. Later, from 1960 on, the hall was closed and totally derelict. And in 1970, by chance, water department workers were seen here turning off the water. They had a demolition order and said, "This building is coming down in 2 weeks." But that was when a group of musicians, music lovers, architects, preservationists, and citizens rushed forward to say that this was a building of such quality, history, and tradition that it must be preserved. That was the beginning of the campaign to save Orchestra Hall. And one can see in photographs the sad condition of the ornamentation and decoration of this building. However, much like the city of Detroit, its foundation was impeccable, and it was on that that we rebuilt. And it is on that that we are recapturing the many traditions that go into the history of this hall. In the very near future, the Detroit Symphony will again make its home at Orchestra Hall.
In view across from Orchestra Hall and a block east of Woodward is Detroit's $600 million medical center, the third largest of its kind in the world. And just ahead is another stretch of buildings with extraordinary echoes from the past. First, let's go bowling. Detroit is known as America's bowling capital, with more bowlers per capita than any other major city. The Garden Bowl, established in 1913, claims to be the country's oldest bowling center. It's part of a complex which includes the Nome Restaurant and the old Majestic Theater, closed now but waiting for a revival on this part of Woodward. The street looked like this in 1921, and a decade later, the Majestic was known as the House of Talking Pictures. Just to the north, on the west side of Woodward, is a pink granite Romanesque mansion. In its day, it was known as an American palace and considered the state's most elaborate and impressive private home. It was built by lumber and shipping magnate David Whitney Jr. and completed in 1894 at a cost of $400,000. Its 42 rooms contain 20 marble and onyx fireplaces, stained and leaded Tiffany glass windows, elaborately carved wood paneling and parquet floors. Decades later, the mansion was donated to the County Medical Society and then sold to the Visiting Nurses Association. It was used for office space. All of this was painted white and filled with partitions, desks, and file cabinets. Finally, a few years ago, new owners decided to restore the home to its original grandeur and turn it into a restaurant. Today, it flourishes as one of Detroit's premier dining spots. Right next door to the Whitney is the old Verner's plant. Opened in the 1950s, it featured one of Detroit's favorite signs, a gnome pouring a huge bottle of ginger ale into a glass. 2 years ago, after four locations and 119 years on Woodward, the company moved to the suburbs. The boarded up plant is only an eyesore now, waiting for demolition. Directly across Woodward is the old Garfield Building. 10 years ago, it was the headquarters of Wayne County Community College. But today it stands empty, invested only with the dreams of its owner just up the street, the Cathedral of St. Paul Episcopal. The church hopes to develop the building into the kind of loft apartments so popular with young marrieds. And on the chance those couples will not want to send their children to the troubled Detroit public schools, St. Paul's is starting its own elementary. Ironically, the headquarters of Detroit's public school system is right across Woodward in the old Maccabees Building.
That's Dwayne Eddy and his twangy guitar on WDET, and George Harrison playing the other guitar with Dwayne on his new album. That piece is called The Theme for Something Really Important.
On the building's 15th floor, public radio's Dave Dixon broadcasts his popular freeform music show on FM station WDET. He plays whatever strikes his fancy: electronic, jazz, blues, rock, or classical. WDET moved last week to a new location, but in the 1930s, these studios were occupied by WXYZ when it broadcast radio dramas like The Lone Ranger and The Green Hornet all over the country. Today, Dixon has a visitor from that illustrious past.
This is the big studio. I guess this is the historic Lone Ranger
studio. This is it. From out of the west come the thundering hoofbeats of the great horse, Silver! It's the Lone Ranger rides again.
You know what I...
Rube Weiss, one of Detroit's most famous voices, was 20 when he began filling several different roles on the old Lone Ranger show.
And the Lone Ranger was created for radio right here.
Right here in this building, the old Maccabees Building. And this was the studio where all the shows were done. There was one microphone hanging from the ceiling down, and everybody worked around that
one microphone
mic
for all the actors.
And it was an ensemble effort, really. The same actors had worked together all of the time. And knew what to do. And as soon as you had your line and you finished, you better get out of the way because there were two guys coming in.
Here comes Collins, the scout.
City. What's the word, Collins?
Good news, Captain Reed. It's all clear.
With sound effects men over in the corner breaking
the sound men were
things
over
and
in the corner doing
gunshots
live
and saddle
sound and
saddle sounds and everything.
Not just saddle sounds, but actually he had a huge carriage wheel. And the guys would turn it in a box of sand and gravel.
And that would be the sound of a coach?
That would be the sound of a coach.
Oh, yeah, my.
I want to take him alive. That shot.
Look out.
Steady there. Steady, boy.
Over there. Killer in ambush. Him right way.
Toto, he missed me, but he shot my horse. Get after him. Get him
up. There were always gunshots, and if the gun didn't work, and we say, all right, shoot him, shoot him. And you'd hear click, click, and nothing happened. And the guys would finally say, all right, stab him. You know, well...
And being a young man, 22 years old, and she was magnificent as she is today.
In a moment, when we come back, a love story at the Institute of Arts.
This World of Difference special is brought to you in part by McDonald's. It's a good time.
In Switzerland, when I was 7 years old, I was the youngest child to climb a certain mountain. I've never been afraid of heights.
Lucy Ann Block and her husband, Stephen Dimitroff, both in their 70s, were climbing the scaffolding without hesitation when we found them at the Institute of Arts. They met and married more than 50 years ago while working for the great Mexican painter, Diego Rivera. The Institute's famed Detroit industry frescoes are among Rivera's masterworks. And today, Lucy Ann and Stephen are back to undertake the first thorough cleaning in 50 years. The job prompted a welter of memories of the master.
All the assistants used to stay here and watch him because here you have 300 pounds on that scaffold way up there, and he needed colors, he needed water, he needed brushes sometimes. He rarely came down to go to the lavatory. It's phenomenal. And when he came down, he walked very softly.
At least with me, he was very kind and very trustful. He used to say, women are smarter than men.
This is a magnificent portrait of a city. I don't think there's a city in the United States that has this kind of a example of what the city is. Never mind the condition we are as a town, this is still the city of Detroit because that's where the car really began in mass. This is the expression of the automobile factory.
Across Woodward from the Art Institute is another building of imposing grace from the 20s, the public library. Immediately north is the historical museum, with its lower level featuring the recreated cobblestone streets of old Detroit. This is a replica of the first Kresge's Five and Dime. The actual store was built on Woodward in 1899. One block up the street is another replica. For the past 40 years, it's been the home of Smiley Pianos. But when it was built in 1891 for one of Detroit's railroad tycoons, the idea was to construct a scale model of a famous chateau near Tours in France.
It carries less time. You don't have to use no force, and you don't have to use a gun. The car game is the quickest, the safest, and the most profitable way it is.
A year ago, we found Charles, a veteran car thief, in the Wayne County Jail. But he's also done time on Woodward. A prison on Woodward? Not quite. But this building, formerly the Diplomat Motel, is a halfway house now for the State Department of Corrections. To ease prison overcrowding, supposedly low-risk, non-violent criminals like Charles spend their nights at the Diplomat and their days wherever they please.
I love cars. And that's where I'm gonna be at, you know, working on cars.
With his life devoted to skirting the law, Charles could have been the invention of Detroit's great crime novelist, Elmore Dutch Leonard. With many of his 25 novels set in Detroit, Dutch has often written about Woodward, most recently in a book to be published next year called Freaky Deaky. In the passage he read to us, two of his typically unsavory characters are driving in the New Center area.
Woodward Avenue, Skip said. This is the only town I've been to where the horse parade around on the main drag. Look at that one. Robin said, you don't know she's a whore. Skip glanced at Robin, puffing on her cigarette, still showing him some muscle. He said, you're right. 10 o'clock at night, this broad puts on a sunsuit to get a tan. It's a mini skirt and halter. I'm wrong again, Skip said. He thought a while and said, the way they got these lights timed, I don't understand it. They make you stop about every block and look at how depressing this town has become. Where is everybody? I know they're across the river at Jason's. They call it the Royal Canadian Ballet. These girls will dance bare-ass right at your table. For 10 bucks, you can have your picture taken with Miss Nude Vancouver and her two breasts. There you are, the four of you smiling at the camera. Be nice to have framed, you know, as a memento, your visit to Canada. There's more going on over there than here. What I don't understand is why the car companies don't do something about it. They let the Japs eat the ass right out of their business. Just sat there and let it happen. You understand that? No answer. She didn't know or she didn't care. Well, I'm glad your mom buys American. I like a big roomy automobile.
Two blocks away, just north of Grand Boulevard, we found Detroit Police Commander Gil Hill. He was Eddie Murphy's boss in the Beverly Hills cop movies, and he told us about a case he closed on Woodward.
Early in 1967, this bank was robbed by a lone gunman. The surveillance cameras happened to take a remarkably clear picture of the holdup man and the distinctive tinted glasses he was wearing. About a month or so later, Rufus Anderson and I, who were working together at holdup at the time, were assigned to the area of Woodward and Alexandrine, which was experiencing a series of early morning robberies. We were also studying for the police exams at the time, and the first couple of nights I took my books out, and while Rufus would be surveilling, I'd have my flashlight and I'd be reading. When we came in that second morning, Lieutenant Sheeman caught me with my books, chewed me out, said he sent us out there to look for holdup men and not to be reading. The next night I left my books in the station, of course. And we worked all night and after daybreak, and I looked up and I saw this guy standing there, and he looked just like the photos in the bank. So we got out and we talked to the guy, told him that we wanted him, wanted to talk to him regarding a bank robbery. He said, you couldn't want to talk to me. I just got into town. Asked me what was his name. I told him we didn't know his name. So he said, why don't you go and check? I'll wait right here for you. And if you want me, you can come back and pick me up. Of course, we couldn't do that, and we took him in. We checked his print, and there was an immediate match by the FBI. His name turned out to be Hill. We then went back to the bank to check with the person who had been robbed, and the teller who had been robbed on that particular occasion, his name was Hill also. And this particular story made the national news that Hill catches Hill, who had robbed Hill.
Crime has always been a reality on Woodward, especially at night in this neighborhood. Nearly every kind of vice and illicit compound are available to those who wish to pay the price. Street corner peddlers hawk heroin and cocaine, while prostitutes, both male and female, young and not so young, offer their five-minute favors to those willing to risk venereal disease or worse. Police sweep the street on occasion, but always, inevitably, the players return. On this Monday night, we found four young women working on one block with no apparent concern about law enforcement. And a little farther up the avenue, these two, oblivious to our hidden camera, seem willing to stop at almost nothing in an effort to dance their way into someone's wallet. Of course, there are those who work Woodward not to give, but to take. As our producer learned after we shot this footage, when he returned to his car parked on one of the avenue's brightest stretches just below the boulevard. Cost to the insurance company for the window, radio, and dashboard? $1,500. Ironically, the same area of Woodward often worked by pushers and prostitutes contains so many churches that it was once known as Piety Hill. Most of the churches are still doing their good work. But many have changed, both their name and congregation, as the ethnic makeup of these neighborhoods changed. The People's Community Church, for example, was once the First Baptist Church. Today it runs a daycare center, and artist Michelle Gibbs was putting the finishing touches to a colorful mural on a formerly dingy wall in the playground behind the church annex. The mural describes the struggles and triumphs of American blacks, and Gibbs calls it a wall of enlightenment, hope, and future possibilities. Just up the street, the beautiful Temple Beth El building, designed by the great Albert Kahn, is now the Lighthouse Cathedral. Across the way, Considine Recreation used to be the Jewish Community Center, and the Little Rock Baptist Church was once Central Woodward Christian. Wednesday evening service, the Reverend Jim Holly was preaching his view of the city's deepest need.
It is not brick or mortar that makes a city great, but it's people that makes the city great. It's not brick or mortar that makes schools great, but it's children that make schools great. And if a child does not open a book in an old school, what good would it do to build a new school? For if he opens a book in neither the old or the new, you still grow up to be illiterate.
All right, all right.
Coming up, you never know who you might find working on Woodward. Old parents and children. At Northern High School, we asked some 10th graders and their teachers about their experiences on Woodward.
Every floor of Hudson's, it seems, had it was selling on all floors, and the Kearns was opening Crowley's, and it just was a beautiful place.
I was going to the store for my mother 3 or 4 days ago, and I met one of my friends, and I didn't think he was the type of boy that would be selling drugs, but he was out there in front of the store selling drugs about 9, 10 o'clock. He had sold some drugs to a girl that I knew and I recognized that go to the school. And when I came out the store, I talked to him about it. And I told him that if he was going to sell the stuff, don't come around my house no more, because he wasn't no real good friend if he was going to sell the junk to another schoolmate.
And Woodward Avenue captures the very essence of life and reveals to us what life in the 1980s represents. And which one will you accept? What values will you take? Will you take the cultural? Will you take the beautiful? Will you take the religious? Or will you take the crime and the destruction?
A block north of Northern High School is the Ingleside Convalescent Center. When we stopped by, a party thrown by the staff and community volunteers brightened the tattered dreams of the aged, the infirm, and the unfortunate. To the area's 1.5 million Catholics, the dream of a papal visit came true, of course, last month when John Paul II came to Detroit. The one church he visited, naturally, the center of Roman Catholicism in the Metro Detroit area, Blessed Sacrament Cathedral. The massive and beautiful church was filled to capacity as the weary pontiff renewed himself with prayer and then reached out to the faithful. One block from Blessed Sacrament is Aknartoon's Eatery, Detroit's only Muslim soul food cafeteria. The cooks at Aknartoon's observe Muslim dietary laws, so the barbecued ribs, for example, are lamb, not pork. In any case, everything looks delicious. Only when the street signs change from green to blue do you know you're in Highland Park, a city surrounded by Detroit, with a proud history, a troubled present, and an uncertain future. That McDonald's on the left is where Vincent Chin saw his dreams end when Ronald Ebens beat him to death with a baseball bat in the middle of Woodward. Highland Park currently is reeling from the blow to its tax base suffered when Chrysler announced it was moving its world headquarters to the suburbs. But the city is no stranger to corporate flight. That huge complex to the east is the Ford Motor Assembly Plant. Designed by Albert Kahn, it was the world's largest automobile factory, turning out 9,000 Model Ts a day.
This plant, when it was opened in 1910, was often referred to as the Crystal Palace because it had so much more light and so much more ventilation. Henry Ford said in his book and his autobiography that he got the idea for the assembly line from the Chicago meatpackers who disassembled animals. Well, in January 1914, Henry Ford decided to double the pay of his workers. They were making on the average about $2.41 a day. Overnight, without any advance warning, $5 a day. Within a couple of days, there were 10,000 men standing outside this plant in freezing weather, demanding a job for $5 a day. The situation got so out of hand that Ford had to turn fire hoses on these people to quell the riot.
North of the long obsolete plant is another landmark on Woodward, the Powerhouse Gym. In the 1800s, much of Woodward was a corduroy or plank road built with large logs. But in the marshy land to the north, travel was often problematic. Finally, in 1909, the world's first concrete road was built on Woodward between 6 and 7 mile roads. Within 7 years, the concrete extended from the river to Pontiac. Today, Woodward between 6 and 7 runs along Palmer Park. And on the patio at Salute's restaurant, folks from the Michigan Organization for Human Rights were talking about this area's reputation as the center of Detroit's gay community.
You know what I find fascinating about the gay community, though, here in Detroit is that it's tended to follow Woodward all along, starting downtown and going along the Boston Edison area, which I guess is coming back now as a gay area, mm-hmm. Moving up through Highland Park, and you've got the bookstores and the bars and the restaurants. And now, true enough, they're continuing to move north. I gave Palmer Park a year and lived there, but was frankly getting scared. I had friends that were mugged. Trouble parking.
You can go into Birmingham now, and believe me, you know where the community has moved.
Across from Salute's, on the west side of Woodward, Palmer Park is lined with beautiful old apartment buildings. The park itself was designed by Frederick Olmsted, the man responsible for Belle Isle and New York Central Park. By day, it's a place to play or relax. But at night, many say it's a dangerous place to be avoided. North of 7 Mile, those trees and shrubs harbor one of urban America's finest residential neighborhoods. These homes, whose backyards border Woodward, are among the more modest dwellings in Palmer Woods. Just up the street at the fairgrounds, we found a familiar-looking fellow working as a blacksmith.
Okay. Well, I grew up at about 9.5 mile in Woodward, 3 houses from Woodward, so I've watched the whole world go by, up and down Woodward, presidents, generals, and of course, 1.5 miles away is the state fair, and I came here probably 2-3 times every fair, you know, 2 or 3 days in a row, and I'm still delighted to come back. As a young child, I came with my mother, but as an older child, I came, you know, a teenager to run around here and eat the food and go to the arcade, obviously, and things like Dodge 'em cars and the chance to see a lot of farm animals, which you otherwise would never see. You don't see them in a zoo, but you can see them here. I believe that the concessions and the rides and the exhibits are cleaner and safer and more family-oriented now than they were when I was a teenager running around here wondering what was inside the tent with the barker outside.
There are many final resting places on Woodward, but directly across from the fairgrounds is perhaps the most prestigious, Woodlawn Cemetery. Some of Detroit's most famous names can be found here on some of the most elaborate monuments. By contrast, across the 8 mile road border between city and suburb is a small Jewish cemetery called Beth Abraham. In just a moment, we'll head for the zoo. Stay with us. It's farmland. Then, like most Detroit suburbs, Ferndale grew quite rapidly from farming community to village to city. And the major factor in its growth was the development of Woodward, first as a route for electric interurban rail cars like this one, and then, once the concrete was laid, for the automobile. From the beginning, Woodward and 9 Mile was the center of downtown Ferndale. It wasn't long before the intersection was jammed with traffic, and the village's first response was to install a crow's nest from which a police officer could direct all those cars coming to and from the city. Soon it was clear that the only answer was to widen Woodward. And by 1926, the new highway had 2 40-foot lanes separated by a parkway with the rail tracks in the middle. Over the next 4 decades, businesses flourished in Ferndale as major housing developments were constructed in the northern suburbs. But with the coming of the shopping mall, many commercial strips, like this one, suffered badly. Ferndale has seen some tough times. But this strip is doing quite well, thanks in part to a number of modest businesses that seem to serve as anchors. Paperbacks Unlimited has been for decades one of the area's favorite bookstores. If they don't have it, they'll order it for you. The Rialto Cafe is a classic 50s diner with an 8-course meal still under $5. Even a much-publicized shooting incident a few years back couldn't stop the Rialto. The wheels on that old car at Wetmore's used to spin, but the garage still turns out solid repair work. And for something completely different, try the Larmel Tattoo Studio. Young Don Johnson did, and tattoo artist Mel McElhenney suggested a bird of paradise. It took him more than an hour to finish his work. At 10 Mile Road, what used to be Woodward is now a huge ditch. Construction on the long-awaited east-west freeway has changed the face of this area considerably. But Woodward's most recognizable restaurant, the Wigwam, already had disappeared from here by 1970. Still there, across the ditch, though, is radio talk show host David Newman's favorite spot on Woodward.
There are people who say we shouldn't have zoos at all. A zoo is a jail for feeling creatures. It generates surplus animals which have to be killed. All true. And yet I come to the zoo regularly and make no apology for it. Sometimes it's for that strangely calming illusion of the peaceable kingdom. Sometimes I just need to see the face of a living tiger, and never mind that he's neither wild nor free. Other times, strangely, it's the casual visitors that catch my eye. The brood of adolescent mallards gliding past resonant exotics. Sometimes it's the sudden love affair of a bear and his broom. And sometimes it's the peculiar, dim, almost rock-like prehistoric remoteness of the giant tortoises. All of it restores my soul. Meanwhile, the Detroit Zoo has become a much better place than it was. Newly renovated, more rational in terms of the exhibits it does show, like the cooler climate guanaco and two-humped camel, and the ones it doesn't show, like costumed chimps. I could wish that the animals were less confined, that the descendants of these animals really could explore their genetic destinies in the wild someday. But I also know that the world of wildness is falling back and disappearing. If you follow the news of that world, and your heart isn't already broken, then you have an innocence that I can only envy. It's a world in which the countries with the last great herds of wild animals are doubling their human population every 10 years, and gorillas are slaughtered for their value as ashtrays. Against that backdrop, a zoo makes sense. As it is, it's the only place where average people can see living reminders of the wild world we're destroying. Ours is the Detroit Zoo, a pretty good one, in the process of getting better.
Back at the turn of the century, much of Woodward through Royal Oak looked like this. Well, some of the trees may still be here, but imagine what a time traveler from those days might think if he were to stop at the old Northwood Inn, which has been at this location in Berkeley for the past 100 years. Today, it's the home of Mark Ridley's Comedy Castle.
I grew up in the era when it was cool to cruise between the totem pole and Ted's drive-in. Yeah. You used to eat those burgers down at the totem pole. Yeah, they had that secret sauce on them. I didn't know what that was until the neighborhood pet started leaving.
Woodward above 11 Mile offers a number of night spots popular with young people. This one named itself after the avenue. Yes, rock and roll is still going strong on Woodward. But if you're old enough to remember, you'll hear other echoes along here as well.
When nothing else was left but to meet fire with fire and force with force, there arose a Franco.
The strident voice of Father Charles Coughlin. Heard by millions across America on the radio in the 1930s, Coughlin became so popular for a time that he drew up to 400,000 letters a week, many with donations that helped him build the shrine of the Little Flower Catholic Church at the corner of 12 Mile. The fiery priest's rabid anti-communism finally moved him to support dictators like Franco and even Hitler, until he was silenced by Detroit's John Cardinal Dearden in 1941.
To help tear down the cross.
Little GTO, you really looking fine.
Kids were cruising up and down out here way back in the 40s. I was one of them. 10 Mile Road was the southern limit, and I suppose Square Lake Road was the northern limit. The cruising became serious racing when very powerful, very fast cars like this one became available at just about the same time that kids suddenly had a lot of discretionary income. But it started here because Woodward was one of the pioneer multi-lane highways, and you could have four lanes of kids driving along side by side talking to each other. We'd start here, find our friends, drive along, chat back and forth between cars, drive along, find somebody else we knew, or find somebody from another school, shout some insults, and then maybe a race would take place. People wanted to style and profile to see and be seen in these shiny, powerful cars, and the racing really became serious in the late 60s. People from the factories came out, saw what was happening, and started to participate themselves. A lot of factory engineers, even some of the factory marketing people, were out here racing with the kids every night in the week. And when the car magazines found out about it, started doing stories about it, and there were writers coming here from as far away as Los Angeles, New York City, to be part of that scene. And that was when Woodward Avenue was truly famous. It all came to an end, I suppose, in the late 60s. Not so much because of the Clean Air Act and the fact that suddenly the emphasis was on fuel economy and safety, but more, I think, because as the muscle car phenomena became bigger and bigger and better known, it went over the top, and the thing had lost its luster. The local police were getting sick and tired of all the action out here on Woodward Avenue, and the serious people went over to I-75 to race.
Hello, Susan.
How are you, darling?
Good, how are you?
When we come back, we'll go shopping in Birmingham. 1820, when a few hardy pioneers staked their claims to cheap land and built cabins in the wilderness near the Indian Trail to Pontiac, which eventually became Woodward Avenue. Soon a village developed with stores and businesses to supply the goods and services needed on the farms that had spread across the area. And Birmingham has been a great place to shop ever since. Today, you may not be able to buy a horse on Woodward, but you can certainly still buy a saddle. Over the decades, of course, Birmingham became one of the country's most affluent communities. And farther up the street is one of the area's most exclusive boutiques.
Zandro fancies this one, Susan.
I can see why.
Isn't it wonderful?
My goodness, can I hold it up?
In case you're wondering, the dresses Hattie is showing customer Susan Feinberg are by South American designer Lisandro Sarasola, and each costs a modest, for Hattie's, $800. One of Birmingham's favorite stops for refreshment is the Midtown Cafe. On this day, we found two Detroiters, Patricia Burnett and Dr. Colette Bellinger, having a drink on the balcony. Dr. Bellinger is an MD, and Patricia, a Miss America runner-up in 1942, is a painter who recently traveled to the Philippines to work on a portrait of President Corazon Aquino.
And now I'm doing the mayor, who is the world's worst person to paint because he refuses to come for a sitting. And I think I'm painting it mostly from imagination. And he's coming off very well because I think of him as my black Clark Gable, you know.
Woodward and 15 Mile or Maple Road is another of the area's best known intersections. This is what it looked like 100 years ago, back when Woodward was called Saginaw Street. That Civil War monument in the middle had been moved to make way for the interurban when this shot was taken 20 years later. A few blocks north, Woodward looked like this at the turn of the century. Today, the east side of the street is lined with art galleries. We stopped at Mary Wright's Zosia Pele Gallery.
Even though it's a painting, he's not using traditional oil paints and a brush. He's using a technique of spraying primary colors, yellow, red, and blue. And he gets this wonderful, brilliant painting. Look at it with a microscope. This is what a good way to understand the method. You'll see little specks, which are only yellow, red, and blue. And it gives you this terrific gem, jewel-like quality, as far as the color, to what would be a depressing subject, possibly. Woodward Avenue, a traffic jam on a rainy night.
Well, if you shop till you drop in Birmingham, just north of 16 Mile in Bloomfield Hills are the lovely grounds of the Manresa Jesuit Retreat. Manresa has been here since the 1920s, when the land was purchased and developed by several Catholic businessmen in Detroit. It was used by the laymen, just men, no women allowed in those days, as a place for peaceful meditation and spiritual renewal. Today, it's still offering the same thing to groups of men, women, and married couples. To the north on Woodward are more church institutions serving other denominations, including the Mormons and the Unitarians. This stretch of the avenue is basically a non-commercial green belt, though there are several new office buildings. But then Bloomfield Hills has attracted professional people from the very beginning. Back in the 1820s, the first 10 men to buy land here were all professionals. They included a judge, two physicians, a church deacon, and a steamboat captain. Residential growth in Bloomfield exploded in the 1950s, and it's still going strong today. Several exclusive condominiums have gone up, and large new homes continue to be developed. But we were curious about the folks who live in the few old mansions that still stand on Woodward, hidden behind all those trees. One day we came upon freelance photographer Tom Weschler taking pictures of his wife and young son in their front yard right on Woodward.
Wonderful. This is working out real good. I think you're going to be a model, Ian. I'm not quite sure.
It looked like fun, but Tom was actually working to get a shot for a magazine ad for his wife's business in Birmingham. The Weschlers live in a carriage house on the property, and they told us about their landlord who lives in this beautiful old home up the hill. He's got the whole estate up for sale, they said, so we stopped by for a tour of the house.
Hi, how you doing? William Wortley, this is my daughter, Kristen. Come on in. Nice of you to come. House was built in 1911. This is the library. It was built by a gentleman by the name of Colonel Brady. This is the dining room. When I was a kid of 15 years old, cruising Woodward looking for women, I always wanted to live in an estate like this. This is the original kitchen. Turn this into a breakfast room. It's hard to believe that a house of this expanse had a kitchen this size. You're looking at the original refrigerator. Still works today. The estate consists of 23 rooms, 6 bedrooms, and this little box here helped the servants know where the service was needed. This is the family room. We're about a 3-minute walk from Cranbrook Institute. Come on in the living room. The property is just under 6 acres, and it is being offered for sale, and the price is $1,100,000.
Old Colonel Brady built his home just 4 years after this picture was taken in 1907. You're looking down the hill on Woodward toward the intersection at Long Lake Road. Today, at Long Lake, the lounge at the Fox and Hounds is a favorite night spot for area singles.
By my love, by my
The Greenbelt continues above Long Lake, but even out here, Woodward can surprise the first-time traveler. Those igloo-style buildings are the Martin Luther King domes at Roper City and Country School. George and Anna Marie Roper fled Nazi Germany in the 30s to pursue their dream of humanistic education for gifted children. Today, the school they founded includes preschool through the 12th grade.
Very good.
The school's philosophy emphasizes social responsibility and individual expression. And in the art room, these youngsters were working on a family tree project. Little Ed Lesniak told us about his work in progress.
Well, me and my sister are arguing. My dad's up on the boat, and my grandpa's up in the crow's nest going cock-a-doodle-doo. And mom is parachuting, and my grandma's parachuting.
This stretch of Bloomfield Township, north of Roper, offers more apartments and condos until you approach Square Lake Road. That was the traditional turnaround spot in the cruising days of the 50s and 60s. Back then, you were likely to stop at this building when it housed the famous Ted's Drive-In. Like all the old drive-ins on Woodward, Ted's fell victim to changing tastes and customs over the years as kids found other ways and places to meet and greet friends. North of Square Lake, Woodward heads toward the city named after a brilliant Ottawa chief who plotted a bloody demise for the white man in this region 200 years ago. Chief Pontiac's plan failed, of course, but the village which bore his name became the Oakland County seat. And by 1836, 40 to 50 pioneer wagons a day traveled the trail here from Detroit to Pontiac. Surprisingly, this spot on the west side of Woodward still offers a hint of what the area was like 150 years ago, when the marshy landscape often stymied or even swallowed up horse-drawn wagons. On this particular day, just a minute to the north at St. Joseph Mercy Hospital, we found a miracle about to happen.
Oh, you got a boy. All right.
Dr. Anan Abdel Rahman delivered Alexander Keegan Flees to this world and to his parents, Susan and Barry. A healthy 10-pound, 5-ounce baby boy, Alex is the fourth child born to Mr. and Mrs. Flees, and they seem to find him just as amazing as their first three children. We felt privileged to be here at the beginning of what we hope will be a long and happy life. Good luck, Alex.
Oh, he looks big.
He's huge.
He's huge.
Well, how can anything follow that? There were other places we might have stopped between the hospital and here at South Boulevard where Woodward ends, but nothing seemed quite appropriate after the birth of little Alex. North of the intersection here, Woodward turns into Saginaw Street and heads for downtown Pontiac. So this is where our journey ends, and we hope you've enjoyed it as much as we have. The truth about Woodward is that it's always changing. Obviously, we could have stopped at many other places and talked to a lot of other people. Maybe the thing to do is to take your own trip on Woodward. As we've seen, there's much to share and much to learn about our community and about ourselves. I'm Mort Crim. Good evening.
This World of Difference special has been brought to you in part by McDonald's. It's a good time for the great taste of McDonald's. And Perry Drugstores. Make it easy. Make it Perry. This presentation has been part of the World of Difference Project, whose partners include the Anti-Defamation.